welcome to our very special Star Wars Astronomy on Tap. So I'm Charlotte, and
I'm Yair.
Okay, and so tonight's going to be a bit different from what we've been doing before. So we're going to have one talk in two halves with two speakers giving the talk together. And you're going to have an opportunity to ask questions after the talks in the two sections. We'll do astronomy in the news and a break in between, just like normal. And as always, this is not a lecture. Feel free to get around, you know, walk around, get drinks, get food. And I hope you enjoy the evening.
Yeah. So we're also going to have some prizes at the end. For those of you in costume, you'll get prizes. And for the lame rest of you, if you have raffle tickets, we'll raffle some prizes for you, despite the fact that you did not come in costume. So the event today is hosted by LCOGT, Las Cumbres Observatory Global Telescope. It's a network of worldwide telescopes used in astronomy and education based here in Goleta. And it'll come up again today, and there's more information in the back for those of you who are interested. You'll notice some of us have glow necklaces on. You don't. That's a problem. Anyone who has a glow necklace on is an astronomer or a LCOGT staff member. Feel free to ask them questions about astronomy, anything you hear here tonight, or anything you're interested in. And we'll be hanging around at the end as well if you have more questions. Okay, let's get started with our speakers today. So like Charlotte said, we have two speakers who are going to be giving the talk together in two parts. The first one is Andy Howell. Andy's a professor at UCSB and a staff scientist at LCOGT. Yeah. So Andy is not only a professional astronomer, he is a very professional Star Wars geek. And just to illustrate how much he is a Star Wars geek, okay, so really this guy, like he's, you know, really professional grade Star Wars geek. And this is how I found him in the office one day. This is his office. And then, like, from the other side, he also has, like, that on his wall over there. And then one day I walked in and found this on his whiteboard in the office. So he had seen, like, a teaser for Rogue One, the next movie that's coming out at the end of the year. And in the teaser, you see the Death Star kind of looming above some planet or moon. And so he did the calculation, how big it is, where it needs to be, you know, the orbit. And he put this online, and then he got an email from the executive producer saying, oh, you know, you caught us. That doesn't really work out with what we were trying to do. Okay, so that's the level at which Andy is a Star Wars geek. Okay, just so you know, we got the professionals here for you tonight. Our second speaker is Chelsea Harris. Chelsea's a grad student at UC Berkeley, and she came down here because she's also a Star Wars specialist. She even takes it higher than Andy does. Let me demonstrate that. So at UC Berkeley and at many astronomy departments, they have like Astro Tea. This is some afternoon that astronomers gather for tea and to discuss, you know, what they're working on. And so this is what Chelsea prepared for an Astro Tea at Berkeley. Okay, just so you know what we're dealing with here. She definitely deserves it. So we have Jabba that bread, Death Star honey, melon, and these chocolate carbonite figures of Han Solo there. She made it all herself. It's really amazing. And then this actually got the attention, and it got an article. So you can see more stuff here. Everything labeled. You know, there's a bunch more stuff, like asteroid scones and stuff like that. And then this got actually a mention on Gizmodo online because it was that spectacular. Okay, so those are the speakers tonight, okay? Professional astronomers and definitely professional Star Wars geeks. Okay, let's see if we can get started here. OK, Okay, we're gonna get started.
Andy couldn't make it tonight. I have Chewbacca here with me. All right. All right, you ready, Chewie? Okay. Hi, I'm Chelsea. Han Solo. So, okay, the first part of this, we are going to focus on what got me into astronomy, which is basically the thought of interstellar travel and just like the universe as a whole, you know, in various states of sobriety, just contemplate the whole universe. That's the kind of thing that got me into this. So in Star Wars, this is totally fundamental, right? The Galactic Empire would have no control if they couldn't zip across the galaxy. But there are two, you know, fundamental issues when you actually look into doing this kind of thing. So Chewie, why don't you tell them what they are? That's the first one. That's the second. I mean, that's a really good point, right? Because literally what that means is it takes like 100,000 years to cross the galaxy. I don't think that's a trivial point at all. And the way that Star Wars deals with this, which, you know, frankly, like, I don't do this that much. I mostly leave it up to Chewie. But what we do is we use hyperdrive to access hyperspace. But not many people know what hyperspace is. So hyperspace is totally made up. But the way that physicists seek to explain it, okay, so that's how this works, right? We see the movies, and then we just, like, make stuff up around it theoretically to explain it. And what hyperspace is like a higher dimension, right? So in the world that we know, we have four dimensions, space-time. It's space plus one, basically. And then hyperspace is an even higher dimension than that that contains space-time where the speed of light is faster. Therefore, as long as we use hyperdrive to access hyperspace, then we can move faster than the speed of light and just zip around the galaxy way faster than we otherwise could. All right, so if you guys remember, in The Force Awakens, right, they have to escape from Jakku, right? So Rey and Finn escape from Jakku, and we're going to watch the clip from that because at first they don't have hyperdrive. And so it makes the whole getting around the galaxy thing really difficult. So here they are, not hyperdriving away from Jakku.
Shooting.
Celebrating. Okay, so we're showing you the evidence, right? They escape and they celebrate their miraculous escape from Jakku. In the next goddamn scene, they get picked up by Han and Chewbacca, right? So it's this.
Where'd you get this ship?
Name Outpost.
Jakku? That junkyard?
Thank you.
Junkyard. Told you we should double check the Western Reaches.
All right.
And we just want to offer the translation because it was very rudely not offered here. So here's the translation of this interaction.
Han, you asshole, we're at Jakku. They didn't even give the hyperdrive. We're right here. You told me to navigate to Jakku. Yeah. We're at the place that you're talking about. You're acting like it's some faraway deal.
That's why I purposely didn't put windows on this ship, is to not see that. Because it takes light, like 10 minutes, to get from Earth to Mars. This scene is like 5 minutes after their escape, and they haven't fixed the fucking hyperdrive, so they are right outside Jakku. They're like probably in Jakku's atmosphere.
Yeah, they even, it's like if you like robbed a bank and you like walk out the door of the bank, you're like, whoo, that was a good getaway.
We did it. And the cops are just like, oh my God, where the fuck did they go?
Yeah, there's a scene in the middle where Kylo Ren chokes somebody for letting him get away. I'm like, don't, they're right there, they're right there.
To be fair, he's kind of hormonal. Like, yeah, we don't really know. Yeah.
All right, you want to get the clickers?
Oh yeah, let's do the clickers. Okay, so here's the next thing that pisses us off.
Yeah, all right, asteroids. So, I don't know, Chelsea, you do the best interpretation of C-3PO here.
Oh, okay, yeah, let's see. I've had a cocktail and a beer, but let's
see. So this is from Empire Strikes Back.
Right, so in Empire Strikes Back, right, yeah, Han like is just like, how are we gonna lose them? Oh, we'll go into the asteroid field, and C-3PO's like, sir, the possibility of successfully navigating an asteroid field is approximately 3,720 to 1.
To which Han should have, Han should have said, bullshit! The probability of successfully navigating an asteroid field 100%, is 100%.
Yeah.
100%. Because if you stand on one asteroid, you can't even see another asteroid, okay? Unless he is like the worst pilot in the galaxy, right? You'll never run into an asteroid. So,
like, I just think about like how hard we had to try to hit the moon. Yeah. It's like,
yeah, exactly. It's easier than that. To miss the asteroids, I mean.
Not confusing at all, Andy. Good
Yeah. So the average distance is like 10 times the distance to the moon.
Yeah, for our Milky Way. So like, when they're like crashing into Alderaan, which has just exploded, whatever. All right.
But we have since missions to asteroids. That's how we have these cool pictures of asteroids. So the Galileo mission went by an asteroid called Gaspra.
Yeah, but then now we sent, you know, way better robots out for us. And yet...
Wait, no, we're ahead of ourselves here.
No, and yet no space slugs.
Oh, right, yeah, sorry,
Do you have the guide?
Yeah.
Where's the guide?
We have not yet detected space slugs around asteroids, sadly, even though we've sent missions to them. But my favorite thing about space slugs, okay, is that you can buy an oven mitt of the space slug. I don't know where it is. which I could not find this one. But, oh, my favorite thing about this one is you open it up and there's a little Millennium Falcon inside. Okay. So
cute.
So I couldn't find that one, but I did buy a little tiny puppet one, which I was going to use on stage here to do a gag, but I can't find it. So,
oh, well.
Anyway, we'll give it away.
But we're giving it away.
Yeah, at
the
end.
You can have a space lug, exactly. Even though the universe does not. We avoided complaining about the space slug in so many ways. But okay.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. Like, what kind of animal evolved to eat spaceships that
and
might
like,
fly
zero
in there?
And, pressure. It's on an asteroid.
Yeah.
And the Han and Leia are just like, oh, like, it's shaky? Like, yeah, you have no gravity at all.
Yeah, okay. And then there's, like, an atmosphere
Okay,
there.
Andy,
it doesn't make any sense.
Andy,
all right,
Andy.
Yeah, sorry,
I mean, Chewie.
Yeah, wait.
Okay, right. So the next thing we want to tell you about was science. So the science is that we have this probe called Dawn, and because, you know, we're such badasses, we actually put it in orbit around an asteroid, which hadn't been done before. So this is real but false color data of this asteroid series in the outer solar system. It has all these, you know, little patches of salt, I think.
Well, yeah, this crazy feature right here is super bright and is a big mystery, and people think it's made of salt. I don't know.
I think it looks like the back of the Millennium Falcon. Like,
yeah,
I'm disappointed
could be space
by their choice.
I don't know.
But I mean, not only that, right? Like, so they also sent it around Vespa.
Yeah, Vesta.
Vesta, whatever.
Yeah.
A little motorcycle in space.
Yeah. So, So Ceres, the biggest asteroid, is a dwarf planet. So if you think Pluto should be a planet, you got to count Ceres as well, because it's round and everything. Like, in fact, it was considered to be a planet in the mid-1800s until people voted it out, just like people did with Pluto today. But I know, oh, everybody loves Pluto. I hate Pluto. Screw that guy. So
I like Pluto.
So this Vesta is the second largest asteroid, and Dawn went to Vesta also. And the reason it could do that is we have some really cool technology now.
Because the problem is, right, like, things are far apart. So if you try to use something like chemical fuel, you just can't burn it efficiently enough to, like, bring all the fuel you need with you. So then we have this really cool technology called ion engines, which, if any of you guys have read and seen The Martian, is what they use there too. And basically, ion engines are really good if you have a really long journey and you don't need to, like, accelerate a lot, right? So you can just do a really short acceleration. So yeah, we have here, you know, about how it creates thrust by accelerating charged particles. Excitingly, xenon gas, which is the most sci-fi sounding of all the gases. And it has a really small thrust, so a really small, like, push, basically, equivalent to the weight of a sheet of paper, but it's really good at converting the fuel into thrust. So you don't need that much of it to go places. So anything that you need long, slow acceleration, like, say, getting humans to another planet, it's great for it. But, like, it would take 4 days for Dawn to get onto the freeway, right? So, like, it's not impressive.
I want to use it in L.A. Which ties into another thing in Star Wars.
I made
she likes
that.
Puns. It's not me.
I made
it's not
him
me.
Do it. I'm she, so sorry. Yeah. No, I'm not sorry.
So, like, okay, they're TIE fighters, right? But why are they called TIE fighters? The real reason is they look like a bow tie, okay? But there's also, like, in canon reason is that they stand for twin ion engine, okay? So there are xenon atoms shooting out the ass end of this TIE fighter here, okay? That's what's making it go. Now, they probably wouldn't be able to zoom around like that with our current ion engines, but it's still, you know, we've got some of that same technology.
And the other cool part is that it actually kind of looks like a TIE fighter. So, like, this is it all unfurled with its solar panels. But this is it, like, in the lab, and it's, you could probably sit in it, and honestly, I'd be surprised if they didn't.
Yeah, it looks like a TIE fighter, right?
It absolutely does.
So this is the thing that went to Ceres and Vesta. So we've got TIE fighters at asteroids right now.
Yeah. So. Non-weaponized.
Yeah, our TIE fighters make images, not war, but yeah, that's so.
Oh my God. All right, the problem is that even if you had something like this, right, so this is the technology we have, so, you know, maybe we could use this to get humans to a different planet, even maybe a different planet far away, but, like, it would still take really long. So instead of the incredible voyage or the fantastic voyage, getting to another planet is the boring voyage. And most of the time in sci-fi, they just sleep through it. Seriously, that's, like, what you would probably want to do.
Yeah.
And my only caution in exploring this technology is that sci-fi teaches us that if you do that, someone's going to go homicidally insane. You got to pick someone to murder, like, just before you start the journey. It's going to get to that point.
Yeah, I mean, when I wake up after, like, 8 hours of sleep,
I want to kill him.
I'm a monster. And if I wake up after 100 years, yeah, there's no amount of coffee you could carry on that ship that would get me sane again.
Absolutely not. And yet, it's still a promising technology.
Yeah, no, it's cool, like, because mammals do it on Earth. I mean, it can be done. Freaking bears have this technology, and we don't, okay? But...
just another reason to be afraid of bears.
Yeah,
honestly.
Exactly, yeah. Okay, or whatever these are, they have that same technology. Okay, and in the Star Wars universe, the same thing is done to Han Solo, okay, against his will, but they freeze him for a long journey. And so he gets put into, also because of contract disputes, and they didn't have him signed for the third movie. But they freeze him, and it's too bad. Nobody wants Han Solo to be frozen. Who we really wanted to be frozen is this guy. I mean, that's what, and then I would have thought him out in space. I mean, that's the only real
I wouldn't have.
Yeah.
I'll be honest.
Yeah, okay, keep him there.
Yeah, just like project him into space. All right, but like we said, of course, there's not just geeking out, there's also science to this, which we're contractually obligated to talk about. So, Okay, so we're not at carbon freezing yet, but we're making steps to get there. So there's this thing called therapeutic hypothermia, where doctors, if you like need to slow down your metabolism, and especially like medical cases where you need to prevent swelling, they'll just like cool you off to 91 degrees Fahrenheit over the course of a whole day, right? And then they'll reheat you again over the course of the whole day.
Yeah, and in fact, this is a standard protocol for things like a heart attack, where then your brain doesn't get enough oxygen and it could start swelling. So this cools you down to prevent that. And in fact, this happened to my dad. My dad had a heart attack, and my mom, who's here in the audience, right in the middle of the bar, all the way from Florida, did CPR on him for like 15 minutes with the nurse next door. And they thought there was no chance he was gonna live, but after a week of recuperation, this is us, and there's my dad, yes. Might be drinking some beers in the hospital, but anyway, he's made a full recovery. So this technology kind of exists, and it gets even crazier. There's now a like technology that they're doing in Pittsburgh that they're doing it to an even greater extreme. They've tested this out on pigs. They've never gotten to work yet on humans, but they're trying. And if you have a severe like gunshot wound and the blood is like out of your body, they will just replace it with a saline solution, cool you down to 50 degrees, and they have like 2 hours to fix the damage and then put blood back in your body and then try. So in that time, you're not breathing, there's no brain activity, you are dead. The lead author of the study said, they don't like to call it suspended animation because it sounds too much like science fiction, but that's what it is. Okay, so we are working on this technology right now.
But like, how would the Leo rescue look in that case? Like a blood transfusion?
Yeah, I don't know. It doesn't happen as fast. I can tell you, when my dad was frozen like that, I did tell my brother, he's alive, but in perfect hibernation.
Really sensitive, really sensitive. Oh, and speaking of sensitive, the transition we decided on was, when we're on the subject of people dying, we want to talk about Starkiller Base.
Yeah. How about mass genocide?
Oh my God. Okay. Yeah, we were.
I'm not one at a time in it here. I'm mass genociding.
So anyway, Starkiller Base. So we'll show you a clip while we collect ourselves. Destroying the Hosnian system.
So these guys are on a different planet called Takodana, and they're looking up in the sky and they're seeing the destruction of a totally other star system called the Hosnian system, which is not really well established in the movie because it's just all of a sudden they don't establish this planet and some randos are getting killed there.
But look at how expressive the randos are. Not that one, but this one, really. Yeah. Like, he's just...
All right, so they look up and they see this destruction in the sky.
Which, of course, this is a learning opportunity.
Yeah.
So we can tell you, like, could we actually see this going on? All right, so the first thing that we need to talk about is just the Star Wars galaxy. So they officially made a map, and you can't read it at all, but luckily we circled it. So this is the Hosnian system over here.
AKA the people that are about to die.
Yeah, about to die. Our heroes are over here on Takodana. Takodana, which this is the origin, official origin of the name.
Yeah.
Okay. So this galaxy is like 120 light years across, from which, using extremely sophisticated
trigonometry,
we were able to deduce that these are probably about 40,000 light years across or apart. All right, so our heroes are 40,000 light years or so from the Hosnian system that's getting destroyed.
Watching the action.
What?
Watching the action up in the sky.
Yeah, watching it perfectly. So let's look up in the sky.
Yeah, so this is what they see from the planet. Again, Han and the heroes are on this planet. Watch up, look at the Hadrian system, some stuff going 40,000 light years away. Okay, so they see destruction spread all over the sky here. It's hard to see, but this is where the little points are. Okay, the different planets that are getting blown up. All right, is that realistic? Well, we put the moon in the sky for scale, like our moon, how it looks in our sky. That's about half a degree across, which is about 30 arc minutes. Okay, that's 60 arc minutes in a degree.
Okay, now brace yourself. We're gonna show an equation.
Oh yeah, I forgot.
I'm prepping them now.
Yeah, okay, cool. So we can actually calculate then how far away things are. If we assume the planets are about five times the Earth-Moon distance, the Earth-Sun distance.
This is terrible astronomy. This is J.J. Abrams astronomy.
That's an AU. Wait, what?
Oh, nothing. Yeah, you're right. Earth-Moon distance. Yeah, I won't correct you.
So that's about 5 AU from... If we assume it's about five times the Earth-Sun distance, it doesn't matter exactly. You'll see. We can calculate the separation over the distance, and that is... We could put it in terms of light years, and the problem is the angular size, how big we should see this on the sky, is 7 times 10 to the minus 6 arc minutes. Okay, so it should be a millionth of an arc minute.
Which, to give you some perspective, we wrote here, the human eye can resolve things that are 1 arc minute apart. So a million times more separated than this is the limit of what you could see.
Yeah, so you would just see a little teeny prick of light, if that at all. You wouldn't see anything in the daytime.
It would be way too faint.
Yeah, so you would see nothing. So they're only a factor of a million off or so. So yeah.
Okay, yeah. But like, this isn't even the part that like should piss anyone off. The part that should piss you off is the definition of a light year. Literally 40,000 years is how long it would take to see that at all. Like 40,000 years later, our skeleton heroes are just like, what happened?
Yeah.
Like Obi-Wan's ghost is just like, just use the Force and you can know immediately.
Yeah, in the original Star Wars, when Alderaan blew up, like Obi-Wan got like a really bad headache on the Millennium Falcon. He's like, I feel like a billion people just died. Like, they know how to transmit that information in the Star Wars universe without having to have people look up in the sky. I mean, it's stupid. So
especially since The Force Awakens is just a rehash. It's like, just rehash that part too, guys.
Yeah, they
just
already told you how to
do
it. Yeah.
Jesus!
Which does tell you that the Force does travel faster than the speed of light.
Which, honestly, really interesting physics that we're not exploring at all.
Which is cool with us, because that's not, it's not our light. We know how fast light travels. The Force, who knows?
Yeah, hyperspace.
Yeah.
What?
Quantum entanglement. Yeah, that's how the Force works.
Oh my God. Yeah, okay.
Separate talk. Don't worry, later. So, all right, to summarize.
Yeah, so this talk was all about distances. We're almost done. Okay, so first we explained to you about hyperspace, how it's a dimension that contains space-time. So that is what the hyperdrive does, is gets you to hyperspace.
So I would say that is like necessary, not realistic, but you got to do it to tell the story. So that's cool.
A lot of sci-fi uses like Dune.
Yeah, that's cool. But then there's Dawn. Hey, done. We already have TIE fighters at Asteroids, so that's totally cool.
Second thing you learned was we have TIE fighters, and the government isn't telling you.
Yeah, that's right. And then carbon freezing. I count that as pretty, we're on the way. We're close, we're getting there.
But bears did it first.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know what that means.
Yeah.
And then, you know, finally, and the most important thing that you should take away from this, because this is what we took away from The Force Awakens, is J.J. Abrams doesn't understand astronomy at all. Like, he thinks that solar systems and galaxies are the same size, apparently, even though he knows solar systems are within galaxies, which I think of as the, you know, ass and elbow,
He doesn't know his ass from his elbow there.
At all.
I mean, we like the Force Awakens a lot, but, you know.
Not Starkiller based.
He should have just talked to an astronomer.
Yeah, all right. He really should have.
All right, that's it for this segment. Yeah. We'll be back in a few minutes after the astronomy in the news. And if you have questions, they will take your questions. We'll answer them about this segment. And also, if you want to get a shot, we'll do a shot with you at the beginning of our next. Yeah. So get a shot before our next thing, and we'll do one with you.
Okay, if you have any questions, please put your hands up.
Way back there. Oh, am I asking?
Yeah, you're asking a question.
All right, quiet for the question, please.
Am I good? So this goes back to Empire Strikes Back. There's a scene in the Battle of Yavin where the Empire is attacking Hoth, and they're shooting an ion cannon at the incoming, what are the what? Star Destroyer? Yeah. Is that a weapon that's something that could actually happen, or is that a...
I don't remember if we have, glasses.
Yeah. All right. I'll try to take that. All right. So the question is, in The Empire Strikes Back, there's something about Yavin, something about Ion Cannon, something about Hoth. Okay. The answer is the...
Not the question. The question is, do we have Ion Cannons and could we?
Yeah, because so Yavin is in Star Wars, Hoth is in Empire Strikes Back. All right, so yeah, could we have Ion Cannons? And the thing is, with Ion Cannons, their function was not to blow people up. It was to disable the shields. So what that tells you is that the shields are some kind of electromagnetic thing because ions are charged particles. So then if you shoot a ton of charge at the shields, you can screw them up. So, yeah, that, I think that's pretty cool science. Yeah, ion cannons, we could make that today. Kind of.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay. One more question.
Could they even survive hyperspeed?
The question is, could you survive hyperspace?
Hypersleep.
Hyperspeed, yeah, because... Well, it depends on the mechanism that you use to get to that other dimension. So as long as you have a legitimate method for getting from our dimension to the other one, that should be your only problem.
Okay, let's thank Andy and Chelsea again, and we'll see them back for the second part. And we will... We will move on to astronomy in the news in a second here. No. We'll do astronomy in the news. Okay. Okay, so this is a part in the evening where we tell you about the news that happened in astronomy last month and how it was distorted or not in the media. So fix some of the damage there. Okay, so our first story is SpaceX. Last month, SpaceX had their first successful rocket landing on a barge. Yeah. So that is not a trivial thing. Here's one of their previous attempts to land on a barge. So you see the rocket coming down there, landing gear extended. It's not going so well. It's kind of losing balance. And the problem with rockets is they have fuel inside. So when they fall over, they tend to explode, which is what happened in the first attempt. They then made another attempt. Here's another attempt filmed from the barge. So it actually landed, but then one of the legs buckled. And so you know what's going to happen. Yeah. So it's not easy. So why even try to land on a barge? And why even land a rocket? So these rockets take satellites and payload into space and eventually are going to take people to Mars. But the rockets themselves cost like $60 million. So you don't really want to throw it in the ocean. You want to reuse it. That's going to make the difference between being able to do this again and again. Now, why do it in the ocean and not on land, which is much easier? So the rocket launches its payload into space. And by the time it does that, it's over the ocean. So it doesn't have enough fuel, usually, depending on the orbit, to come back to land. So if you want to get to certain orbits, you can't carry enough fuel to come back, so you have to land in the ocean. It's imperative. So a couple weeks ago, they tried again, And this time... Okay, so there's the barge, there's a rocket coming down. Yeah, and they did it. So, for safety reasons also, these barges are completely unmanned. They're total drone barges, there's no one there. And they have really funny names. I don't know if you've heard about this. So the first one from the few failed attempts was called Please Read the Instructions. And this one is called Of Course I Still Love You. And those names are actually from science fiction novels where sentient spacecraft give themselves names, and that's the names they gave themselves. So that's where it's from. And the rocket itself is called the Falcon 9 rocket. And it's called Falcon in honor of no less than the Millennium Falcon from Star Wars. So, you know, going into space in rockets is great, but as you heard Andy and Chelsea say, it's not gonna get you interstellar distances. It's gonna get you to orbit, it's gonna get you to the moon or Mars, but you wanna go to the next star system and check out if there are aliens there, you need a different approach, okay? So our very own Phil Lubin, a professor here at UCSB, has come up with a different idea, and it is totally different, and I'll let him explain it to you in this video.
Here's the dilemma. We know how to get to relativistic speeds in the laboratory. We do it all the time. And then we go to the macroscopic level for things like aircraft, cars, spacecraft. We're pathetically slow. So the question is, can we bridge that gap between what we do now on the macroscopic level with chemical binding energies to relativistic speeds, which are done with electromagnetic acceleration? The shuttle, when it would take off, or the SLS, when it will take off, will have a power off the launch pad of between 50 and 100 gigawatts. Turns out, to get to relativistic speeds with the spacecraft we're talking about, you need basically the same power level. And for about the same amount of time, it takes 10 minutes to get to orbit with the shuttle. It takes us 10 minutes to get to 30% the speed of light with about the same power level, just using different technology. We could propel a 100-kilogram robotic craft to Mars in a few days. If you want to push something like shuttle class, it takes you roughly a quarter a month to get there. Within about 25 light years of the Earth, there's actually quite a few potential exoplanets and habitable things to visit that may be habitable. We don't know, of course. And so there are many, many targets to choose from. The closest is Alpha Centauri, which is about 4 light years away. So photon-driven propulsion is not a new idea. It goes back to the beginnings of thinking about light in both the classical and the quantum mechanical way. There are recent advances which take this from science fiction to science reality. There is no known reason why we cannot do this. There's a roadmap, which you can look at in our paper, to relativistic flight. The system is completely scalable modular, built any size you want, from a tiny one to a gigantic one.
Okay, so Phil Lubin's idea was recently picked up by a billionaire you might have heard of in the Breakthrough Starshot project. So Yuri Milner and Stephen Hawking are now promoting this. This is gonna be like, you send out thousands of iPhone-sized spaceships with a huge sail, then you shine laser light at them from the Earth, and that light propels the sail and accelerates it to incredible speeds, close to the speed of light, and you can get to the nearest star, which is 4 light years away, or 25 trillion miles away, in 20 years, which without this is just simply impossible. So this was announced this month, Project Starshot, and they had a press conference with Stephen Hawking and Yuri Milner, and there's Phil Lubin right there with them. So the problem is, this is probably gonna cost more than $10 billion, but Yuri Milner has given the first $100 million to get it started and start developing the technology to do this. Some of the problems are, you need to get enough power output from the lasers on Earth, you need to point them really accurately at these spaceships, and you need the sail not to vaporize from the laser. It has to get that pressure and accelerate without vaporizing, which I don't know if we yet know how to do, but that's the point of this project. So the idea is you send these out. Some of them make them to Alpha Centauri, our nearest star neighbor, 4 light years away, take pictures, send them back. We can see, like, right there what's going on. So interstellar travel might actually happen in our lifetimes. Okay.
Okay, did anybody see this thing on Thursday night? Can we see it?
Yeah, so this is driving down the I-5 south.
Driving down the I-5.
Look for it. There it is.
Did anybody see that? Yeah, I know. I was teaching that night an astronomy class, and my students were like, Charlotte, we just saw this green thing crash, you know, go across the sky. And I was like, guys, you sure it wasn't a plane? But no, then I looked it up, and actually, they were right. It was a real thing from space, and it was a fireball, really bright meteor that was seen throughout most of Southern California. So these are the people who, you know, people who reported that they saw it from Santa Barbara, Bakersfield, all the way down to San Diego. So just a really bright little rock that's burning up as it travels through the Earth's atmosphere. So nothing to worry about, but, you know, a little reminder that space is here and, you know, maybe we should get on with those space programs. Okay, and then a little bit further afield, we have a new neighbor in the Milky Way. So the Milky Way has satellite galaxies, so these are other smaller galaxies that orbit around it. Lots, you know, we expect all galaxies to have these satellites. I don't think this is on here, is it?
What?
The new one?
No, it's not.
No, okay, the new one's not on here. But we can, some of them we can see from Earth. So
yeah, these two here, the Magellanic clouds.
Yeah, the small and large Magellanic clouds. And if we lived a little bit further south, you'd actually be able to see them just in the sky. So this is a photo that Yaya took in Chile. I think this is pretty awesome. So the large one at the bottom and the small one at the top. So the large one contains about 10 billion stars. So yeah, if you're in the Southern Hemisphere, you can see these pretty easily with the naked eye. But we found this new one, which is called Crater 2. It's actually the fourth largest satellite of the Milky Way. In fact, if it was bright enough, it would take up, it would be like twice the size of the full moon. So you think, wow, like, why did we not see that before? So it's just really, really dim. It's spread out. It has not as many stars, and it's spread out over this area. So there's lots of surveys looking for new satellites in the Milky Way, because we think there should be lots, but we haven't found very many yet. So we're looking for them all over the sky, just by looking for where we see, like, extra clumps of stars. So hopefully, yeah, this is, like, the area that we've been looking in, and hopefully there'll be lots more to see in the future. Okay, who was here last week, or last month? Okay, so you all experts on gravitational lensing now? Yeah? Okay, so does this look familiar, this setup? Okay, so this was a kind of cool discovery about the dark side of the universe. So gravitational lensing allows us to study the dark matter that surrounds galaxies. And in particular, we can see, like, if there are extra bits of dark matter floating around, because dark matter is normally very smooth. And this discovery is pretty cool. So the main lens galaxy is this blue clump in the middle, the blue ball, and then the background galaxy that's been magnified is the red arc. You can see two images. And what these astronomers saw using a telescope in Chile was that just here, there's a little dent in the image of the background galaxy. The red galaxy has a little dent in it. And they realized that the only way they could account for that was by saying that there must be a massive clump of dark matter sitting right next to it. So this clump of dark matter, it has the mass of about a billion times our sun. So, you know, this being able to discover this was pretty awesome. But I think this is probably the worst press release image they could have used. Okay, this white blob doesn't exist. There is no light. It is just dark matter. So I don't know why they thought that when you're trying to explain that dark matter is there, they would put a white blob. Okay. Why not just draw a circle? There is nothing light there. It's just dark matter.
Okay, so more nearby, last week, the beginning of this week was announced three new planets were found in a nearby star Now, we're finding new planets all the time, but these are really special. First of all, because the star is really nearby. It's 40 light years away, okay? So that still takes light 40 years, but that's relatively nearby. And the star itself, so this image on the left is just an illustration, an artist's conception, what that star looks like. It's what we call an ultra-cool dwarf. It's a very faint, dim star, really on the border of what we call a star and a planet. And they have these new three planets orbiting it, very close to it. But since the star is so dim, they're in what we call the habitable zone, where water can exist in liquid form in those planets. And because it's so nearby, and because the star is so dim, and because they're in the habitable zone, we can actually study their atmospheres and see if they have atmospheres, and see if those atmospheres have water, and see if those atmospheres have signs of life. And right now, the Hubble Space Telescope and the Spitzer Space Telescope are pointed at that system and testing if they have atmospheres. So this could be as close as we get to finding life on other planets. And this is the best candidate so far to search. And the system itself was found by the fact that when the planets go in front of the star, they hide a bit of the light. So these are the actual data that were used to discover these planets. The light from the star gets dimmer when the planet is transiting, and then it gets bright again. And these measurements were taken by the small 60-centimeter telescope in Chile, and now it's our best chance of finding life. So something similar to these transits is going to happen in our solar system next week. So as you know, we are the third planet from the sun. Venus and Mercury can pass between us and the sun and then transit across the sun. So Venus did this a couple years ago. We'll do it again in 2117, so don't hold your breath. But Mercury is the other one who can do it because it's in here. So if you're looking at Mercury as it passes across the sun, that's going to happen on Monday morning. We're going to have a transit of Mercury across the sun. So here is a video of what it looked like last time it happened in 2016. So here's the sun, and here's Mercury over there. You can barely see it. That's how big Mercury is compared to the sun. And so it's crossing the surface of the sun. And then if you could see this from very far away, you can measure the amount of light from the sun is slightly lower than usual because Mercury is there. And that's how you detect planets around other stars. And next month, we'll have Rob Sievert from LCOGT tell us about this technique and how we find planets there at LCOGT. Here's another video of the same transit taken from space. Okay, so it's going to be a bit more clear. Let's see if we can. There we go. So there's Mercury right there. Okay. So this is the details of the transit that's going to happen on Monday. So this is Eastern time. So actually, in Santa Barbara, by the time the sun rises, Mercury will already be in front of it, and it'll last until about 11 a.m. on Monday morning. So one very important warning here is do not look directly at the sun. Seriously, don't do it. You'll get blind. Okay, so the Santa Barbara Astronomical Unit, which a few members of which are here, are going to be operating small telescopes with safe filters to look at the sun at the Goleta Camino Real Marketplace next to the theaters, 9 a.m. to 11:45 a.m. You can go there and watch the transit safely through a telescope with the right filter on. Do not do it directly on your own. Don't try to make your own filter. Okay, the sun is really bright. It'll damage your eyes. Okay, just don't. Do that. Well, yeah, if it's foggy, you know, can't argue with the weather. Okay, and our last news story is not related to astronomy, but is definitely related to tonight.
Okay, yeah, this is not astronomy. So it seems like, maybe astronomers do this too, but lots of scientists like to name things after things they've seen in Star Wars. So this is a insect, it's some kind of weird beetle, which is called, I don't know how to say that first word, Trigonopteris tubaca, because apparently the authors of the paper that discovered it thought that the scales on the legs looked like Chewie's fur. I don't know. I don't really see any resemblance there at all. But there's also a whole load of other animals that are named after things in Star Wars. There's a a worm that's called a purple Yoda, because it's purple and it has like flappy ears, or things that are like flappy ears. And there's a whole load of things named after Darth Vader as well.
Yeah. Okay, so this is a new species discovered, I think last week, named after Chewie. Okay. So we're going to take a 5-minute break and get some drinks, get some food. We'll be back with more Star Wars and astronomy.
All right. I heard somebody say, I like that other costume. Yeah, it's hot as hell, though. You tried being dressed as Chewbacca all night. All right. Let's get started. As promised, I said, we'll do a shot with you if you have a shot. So, you got the bourbon. Yep, I got mine. All right, so if you have a shot that is clear, that will be the Greedo shot. If you have a shot that is colored, that will be the Han shot. Which one should we do first? Han shot first. You're up, Chelsea.
All right. Everyone ready? Yeah. Star Wars! Woo!
All right, Greedo, a second later.
Woo! I should have kept my blaster at least.
I know, right? Yeah. All right, so the last talk was about what got Chelsea into astronomy, and that was about distances and figuring out distances. This one is about what got me into astronomy, and my mom, again, who's here, took me to see Star Wars in a drive-in when I was 4, okay?
Good work.
Yeah,
good work.
Yeah. And so I saw Star Wars, and after many repeat viewings, you know, I would see this Tatooine and these twin suns, and I thought, you know, there must be people out there that there are planets around crazy star systems like that. And about a third of star systems are in binary stars, like Tatooine. But the question is, can you actually have a planet in a system like that?
So basically, then, you know, once Andy grew up, scientists were able to answer this question.
Yeah, that's right.
And
at
the answer
time.
Is yes. But you can actually do it in two different ways. Okay, so you have two options.
Yeah, so as she was alluding to, when we saw Star Wars in the first place, we only knew about planets in our solar system. But now we can find planets in other solar systems. There are two options. We need a volunteer to help us demonstrate this on stage. Do we have any?
We're gonna do some science.
Volunteers here. Okay. How about the lady in the table right here, and the closest to the front? Yeah, come on. All right. While she's making her way up, let's just explain this diagram here.
Well, no. Well, okay. So basically, in the first option. Right? Okay, so always you have two stars and one planet. And basically the question is, what the hell does the planet orbit? So in option one, and of course I left my laser over there, but you can read. So on the left, the planet is gonna orbit one of the stars. Wait, aren't you our volunteer? Get
up
here.
Up.
Yeah, we're waiting on you. Come on. And the second option, the planet is gonna orbit both the stars at the same time. And this is gonna change what, basically, if you were standing on the surface of the planet, you see. Okay, so you know that we're the stars of the show. Sure. So we're going to be the stars, and you're going to be the planet.
So what's your name?
Amanda.
Amanda. All right. Thanks for being
a
planet.
So Amanda's our planet.
Yeah.
And whatever she's looking at is what someone on the surface of the planet would be seeing. Okay. So to demonstrate option one, you and I are going to be orbiting. Okay, so you orbit me. So we go around like this, right? And that's her orbiting. But then... What?
Oh, no, do it. Are you moving?
That's interesting. So I'm more massive, so I just like assume I'm standing still, but technically we're orbiting the center of mass, right? Because we're orbiting a common center of mass.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I'm just orbiting slower from out here.
Yeah. So you're right. You just go around me. You're gonna orbit me.
So,
exactly. I'm just not even gonna move. You don't get to see my Doppler shift. So that's gonna be a year. But then at the same time, just like the Earth, you rotate, right? So you can spin in place, and that's you rotating. I'm not gonna hold your hand for this one. Yeah, oh my God. I know, we should have said the least drunk person in the audience, please come up. This is a mistake. Which is why I'm not the planet, because I'm in heels. Yeah, okay, so good. So now we've established this. Okay, so for the first configuration, you orbit me. So, but right now, while you're like on the day side, you see both of us, right? Okay, so both the stars are in the sky. Okay, now Amanda's gonna orbit to nighttime, or rotate to nighttime. So turn around, yep. Now who do you see? They're not stars, only us on stage are stars. Yeah, so nothing. So no planets in the sky at night. Now she goes through this course of half a year. And now, in the daytime, when you're facing me, do you see Andy?
No.
That's right. So the thing about this configuration is, sometime in the year, you see both of us, and sometime in the year, you only see me, right? Yeah. But then at your nighttime side, you turn around, and you're disappointed to see Andy.
Yeah.
That's right.
I mean, who would want to see that?
Okay. Option two. So option one, sometime in the year, you see both of us, sometime in the year, in the sky at once, and sometime in the year, it has to be day to see me and night when you see him. But this time now, Andy and I, you know, we're colleagues, super tight, so we orbit each other.
Yeah.
You are. You're blue. You're the planet. We forgot to explain the diagram. Just go with it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we're orange and yellow here.
Yeah.
We're orbiting each other on the right hand side.
And so
right.
Yeah, go through the course of the year. Take my mic and tell me what you see.
So in the daytime, I see both.
Right.
Yeah, and at night. Over the course of the year.
Yeah.
The year, right? Yeah, through the whole course of the year.
Yeah. And are we like the same separation the whole time?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Exactly. All right,
good
great.
Job. Good all job, right, Planet Amanda.
Thanks, no, Planet Amanda.
You did so good. So good. We will notify the Kepler team.
Yeah.
Look out, Planet Amanda, next thing.
All right, so the important point is, in the first option, you can see the planet, like sometimes in the daytime you can see one sun, and at the so-called nighttime you can see the other. The other one, you always see the stars in the daytime and not at night.
So now, and it doesn't change yet during the year. So now we're gonna do some science. We're gonna show you the only Star Wars data we have outside of the expanded universe. Right, which is that in episode 3, which I insist is not canon because the prequels were shit. Okay, but the important point is that it gives us another data point. So in episode 3 at the end, they see Tatooine and the suns look pretty much the way that they do in episode 4, aka Star Wars. So, question for the audience, which configuration would be Tatooine?
All right, I hear a lot of twos.
Raise
That's
your
right
hand
answer.
If you think it's one.
All right, I already told them the right answer.
Andy!
Sorry.
The game! Oh my god, we were gonna like pit you guys against each other. It was gonna be like craziness.
All right, so it is option two because, you look over at stars and you always see them next to each other in option two. So
always. Two data points.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry, I'm a theorist.
Yeah, so in fact, this is like a real system, Chelsea.
Yeah, well, so basically, right after I got into grad school, I don't use mics a lot. Right after I got into grad school, they found Tatooine. I stayed with supernova research, but this was some exciting shit, right? So they have, the important point about Tatooine system is that the planet itself is part rock and part gas, so it's Saturn-sized, so that's not gonna be a desert planet, but it is in the habitable zone, so maybe it has like a moon or something that would be like Tatooine. And I don't want to bother to explain the K2 data, so Andy.
Yeah, so this is the amount of light we see versus time, and there are these dips that go down, and that's what this is. So when one star passes in front of the other, we see a dip. When the other star passes in front of the other one, we see a dip. And then when the planet passes in front of a star, there's a dip in the light. That's the green things here. And then when the planet passes in front of the other star, we see a dip.
Yeah, and so they made like even a little movie that just shows you kind of what we just explained, right? So these are the two stars here in the center, and then that's the planet. So sometimes, the stars cross each other, sometimes the planets cross the stars, And with Kepler, we can actually see that and then characterize this system and declare it to be something from Star Wars, which is the end goal of all astronomy. Okay.
And this is, NASA has even commissioned posters of some of these planets, like travel posters.
Like retro travel posters. They're so cool, and they have a ton of them. They even have, like, we discover worlds that are never discussed in science fiction because people just don't even know astronomy, to be honest. But, like, some of the things that you can get, like, you can get, like, they always have catchy names, like Kepler-186f. So Kepler-186f orbits an M dwarf, which is the small red star. So, you know, like, plant life on Earth. And it's about Earth size. So plant life on Earth is green because the sun primarily radiates at those wavelengths, right? But an M dwarf is primarily red. So if you were to visit this planet, you would actually see a bunch of red vegetation, potentially, if it had vegetation.
Yes. And, all right, before I get to the next one, I want to say, since some people want to hear, why don't y'all shut the hell up for a second so other people can hear the talk here. All right. And then talk quietly to your neighbors. Get hammered, though.
Contradictory, right. We know.
All right. So, oh, thank you. That worked pretty well. All right. So, all right. The other one here is this some crazy name. But the point is, it's a super Earth. It's also around a dwarf star in a habitable zone. So there could be
Andy,
life on this planet.
They don't fucking know what super Earth means.
Oh, yeah. It means it's really big, big thing that could be solid. And it has really high gravity, right? So this is a thing that there could be people on, but the gravity is super, super heavy. So I actually got contacted by one of the writers for this new Star Wars movie coming out this year, Rogue One, who asked me some science questions about the script he was writing. He was trying to get in touch with Neil deGrasse Tyson, but he couldn't. So he's like, okay,
second
I guess.
Best.
Yeah,
second
I
best.
Guess you'll do. All right. And so I can't tell you what we actually talked about the questions he asked, but I will say that I told him, there's way crazier planets out there than we've ever seen in Star Wars, so please put in some nutso planets like this stuff.
All right, so that was Tatooine. Meanwhile, on Alder... Andy, stop it! Stop it! Jesus, why did they give us two of these? We each have a thing, and we knew it would be terrible. Yeah. Such a mistake. Put yours down. I can't even... This is like my favorite slide, and we just totally goofed it up. Meanwhile, on Alderaan... Okay, so thinking about destroying a planet, usually astronomers think about creating a planet, but, you know, we're pretty dark. So in Star Wars, they kind of, like, introduced this topic of destroying planets. So, like, what would it take to destroy Earth? Well, you have to basically overcome the fact that Earth wants to stay together because of gravity. So that's the gravitational binding energy.
Yeah, so you can actually figure out how much energy it would take to destroy a planet. It's not hard. The equation is just...
It's just physics and math. It's really simple.
Yeah, the G is just a constant, and M is the amount of mass of the planet, and R is the radius of the planet. And it works out to be about 2 times 10 to the 32 joules.
Which is like 10 to the 30 light bulbs shining for a second if you don't use joules all the time. And...
100 watt.
Yeah. We did it.
Yeah.
Okay. So, but the more important question is, like, you know, compared to the energy that we use on Earth, right? So, like, this is a billion times more energy than in all the fossil fuel on Earth, which we are convinced is why you never see the Death Star stop at a gas station.
Yeah, it would take forever to fill up.
Yeah, it's just so many different planets.
Yeah, and also, I just want to point out that Darth Vader said the ability to destroy a planet is insignificant next to the power of the Force. Total liar. He can't think apart a planet, all right? The lasers are way more powerful than the Force.
Yeah. I maintain that that is false because we never saw anyone try, okay? And also, he's Luke's dad, and Luke is super whiny. And presumably he got that from Darth Vader, who was like, nothing can be done. So,
I don't know.
That's where you can include the prequels.
All right.
But moving on with the math.
Yeah.
All right. So with the Death Star, you actually have 9 beams. So they only basically have to have like each of them has to have like a tenth of the energy that you need total, right? So each one is like 10 to the 31 joules. But that's still, just to put it in perspective, that's the amount of sun, of light energy, that the sun radiates like all over its surface if you had like a Dyson sphere in a day. So it's a ton of energy.
Yeah, that makes these guys the dumbest guys in the universe. Because they're standing next to the sun, all right?
Presumably they tried the Death Star so many times and it didn't work that the engineers were like, yes, we can stand in this tunnel.
Yeah, and so that means that all the engineers that created the Death Star were vaporized the first time they used it. So the rebels didn't need to do anything.
Which is why you don't see them like running down the halls, high-fiving each other and like geeking out and like having an office party on the Death Star right after. Okay. But now we want to complain about Starkiller Base like a little more. So Starkiller Base works different from the Death Star, right? So it can destroy like 5 planets and therefore has to have J.J. Abrams' terrible astronomy. So Death Star, you know, charges using the star.
Begin charging the weapon.
Yes, sir. I've been charging.
Here's our engineer right there. Starkiller Base works.
All right, so yeah, it drains the energy from a star. All right, I like that they're thinking about energy. You don't have to go to the gas station, you go to a star. And that is kind of like a binary system that is a type 1A supernova. That's the kind of supernova that I study and Chelsea studies as well. And it's a binary system where it uses its gravity to pull mass off of the companion star. But that happens because this little tiny star is super massive and it just pulls all this matter off the other star.
Yeah, so the stars don't have like some sort of, you know, what was it, like resonance, whatever the hell
it's
that
they
invoked.
It's a resonator or something or other, yeah.
Okay, but the other connection to type 1A supernovae is what happens at the end of the movie, right? So this is what happens to the Starkiller Base, right? This actually, like, in the theater pissed me off. And I was, like, drunk watching this. And I was like, what the fuck? Like, I was so pissed. Okay, so you have the mass of a star now inside the radius of a planet, which I'm cool with because I studied type 1A supernovae and I know what a white dwarf is, which is this. So this is what our sun is going to become, the core of our sun, in, like, 5 billion years. So don't worry about it. But this is supported by quantum mechanics. Okay, so this is kind of a real-ish thing, but like, did they hollow out the planet beforehand?
And then did the dirt go?
Yeah. Like, and then they just keep all this mass in there?
Yeah, and if you do, there are real consequences, right? Like, it makes things really heavy.
It would, like, literally when you add mass, you're increasing the gravitational pull. So like, you would have Kylo Ren pancakes.
Yeah.
At the end of start of whatever the Force Awakens.
Yeah, it increases the gravity like 300,000 times. So I'm imagining Kylo Ren stepping on a scale and like, what the fuck? I'm 600 pounds today. I was 200 pounds like yesterday.
No, like an hour earlier.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
It just makes no sense.
Yeah.
It's like, oh my God, before naming a movie The Force Awakens, you should really read up about how forces work, Abrams.
Yeah, exactly.
Jesus.
And, all right, but here's another point about Starkiller Base is that it can actually travel through hyperspace to get to another star to kill.
Because it could only otherwise destroy one planetary system and then it would just be done.
Yeah,
so it has to be able to travel through hyperspace.
Exactly. It eats a star, so that's a pretty dumb weapon unless you can shoot it through hyperspace.
Just eat the star of the planetary system you want. Oh, my God.
Yeah. Why eat one star to shoot another star? Just eat the star of the people you want to kill. Done.
No, freeze. Yeah. You're fine.
Exactly.
Yeah. And then blast away.
Yeah. Jesus. Anyway, the way it works is it flies through hyperspace, which is it's crazy that you could send a planet through hyperspace. Because if you could send a planet through hyperspace, you don't need to rule by terror. You could rule by saying, hey, we'll just move your planet to a better orbit. You're in a Hoth snow planet. We'll make your climate like Santa Barbara. We'll just move it a little closer to the star. Like, no need. So, but there really are rogue planets that exist. So Starkiller Base has, like, just like snow everywhere, because most of the time it's not hanging out around a star, right? It's just cold because traveling through space, no star.
That is such bullshit though, because the problem is sometimes it is around a star, and when it is around a star, it is super close to that star. This is like 2 stellar radii or something. And the planet that we know of that is like this, that's orbiting a star that is not even as hot as this one in the movie. Okay, the planet that we know that's orbiting this close, the rock on its surface is vaporizing. There is just no way you would have snow on this planet at all, at all.
Exactly, even rock doesn't stay solid, so, yep.
You'd have like a little rock cometary tail, like
behind
you.
Yeah, so in fact, yeah, in this planet, they think the planet is melting. In this real one, it's becoming like a comet. The rock is vaporizing. All right, but in Star Wars, we know that the needs of the script are more powerful than physics.
Yeah, we make some allowances.
Yeah, for example, the Jedi are always, or the cool people, the rebels, they're always on a jungle-covered, life-filled planet, right? But the Empire, they're on like these machines, they're cold, and they're just like a big giant machine. But then
more machine than men now.
Exactly. And then but then Anakin goes to that lava planet.
Not
because,
canon.
Because you know, it's like he's going to hell, okay? But then sometimes they just throw in like,
He's not even using the clicker. Like,
so,
there's no
excuse.
Oh,
that's right. So, but then sometimes they're just like, oh, well, let's have Luke and Leia born on an asteroid, because what the hell? Let's piss off some astrophysicists. It doesn't have any symbolism, but why would they have 1G on an asteroid? Why would it be Earth gravity on an asteroid? It makes no sense. And Luke already said, I was born on Tatooine in an earlier movie.
And again, I maintain that Luke knows fucking nothing about his childhood. I don't know why he's talking about it at all when in the last movie he learned it's all a lie.
Yeah, and Leia too. Leia totally lies.
Oh yeah, she's a big liar. Okay, but the point is that in the real world, physics governs planets. So since all you know about planets comes from Star Wars, we thought we'd go over this a little bit. So in our solar system, we have these 4 inner planets, right? The terrestrial planets. So they're small and they're close to the sun, so they're getting a lot of radiation, so they're hotter, which makes them rocky. They can't maintain an atmosphere because the gas that's hot moves faster, and it's just like, oh yeah, I'm leaving, see you. So all these inner ones, like Earth, are small and rocky. And even like the biggest planets there, the gases that we can retain to have these awesome atmospheres that we know and love, thank you, atmosphere, they're just heavier molecular gases.
But the outer planets are really cold, so they can actually retain an atmosphere. Like, hydrogen moves slow enough that it will stay on the planet because it can't achieve the escape velocity to get off the planet. That allows those planets to go really big and have a higher escape velocity. So the whole point here is that planets actually obey physical laws. So when you write a planet in a movie, like, the size it is actually affects the plot.
Yeah, like, it's fine to have a planet that has, like, really high gravity. Like, just make it not Earth gravity once without being Stanley Kubrick. We'd be happy.
But there's another thing that you can have life on.
Yeah, so, like, a lot of the time when we think about just space fantasies, we think about, you know, going to different planets. But it's a really valid question that scientists ask all the time, which is there life on moons? Which they actually do have in Star Wars and in other sci-fi, right? Like, we have the forest moon of Endor that has these crappy little Ewoks that, oh my god. Oh, I fucking know some people love them. I hate them. They are racist, and I will take it up with you.
Woo, we got some Ewok lovers here. Hey, you know,
some people love the Ewoks. They are awful.
I was at the press conference for The Force Awakens, and they were semi joking that Harrison Ford had it in his contract that he would not do a movie if Ewoks were in it, And they weren't even joking. That was for real. He put it in his contract that Ewoks cannot be in The Force Awakens.
All right. Ewoks are the worst.
So anyway, but astronomically speaking, could we have life on...
Calm down, Jesus.
Yeah.
Calm down, shut up.
Could we have life on moons, Chelsea?
I mean, definitely. So basically, like, for life, right, it's all about water and rock, so, like, silicates. And, you know, astronomers actually did this study in our solar system to say where are we likely to have life. And the answer was basically a bunch of moons, right? Europa, Ganymede, Callisto, Titan, Enceladus. And then, like, the only planet, really, that meets this criterion is Earth. So we have, like, a whole bureaucracy behind this. So the scientists are part of the Committee on Space Research. As soon as we went to the moon, they were like, okay, we need bureaucracy. And Kaspar has said that basically it's so likely that there could be, like, the conditions for life are so favorable on Europa and Enceladus that we need more bureaucracy. So, like, literally, we have to plan space missions around the fact that there might be life on these moons. And so you can't be contaminating that life with, you know, all of our Earth stuff. Although I maintain that if it's to avoid having Ewoks in the universe, I'm okay with contamination.
Yeah, we can kill off Ewoks. That's cool. Ewok lovers. All right.
Ew.
So everybody says, like, then water is the prime ingredient for life, right? And in fact, there's even a thing like astronomers have to kind of compute how many communicable civilizations might there be out there. It's called the Drake equation. And you can multiply up these terms and figure out how many alien civilizations might be out there. But you know, I don't care about finding water so much. I really just want to find alcohol. So
we came up with a new equation, okay, called the drunk equation, where we've added the density of bars, and we think that this should be the fundamental equation.
Yeah, because in the Star Wars universe, the main thing I want to do is go to a bar and drink with a bunch of crazy aliens from all around the galaxy.
Because apparently if I go to a bar, I'll have my life threatened anyway with my Ewok politics.
All right, so I hope you all aliens enjoy some more drinks. That's it for us right now, but we're going to have... some more, like, we're gonna have a costume contest and we're gonna have some more questions and answers. So here we are again with Charlotte and Yair.
Okay, so I think if these guys are sober enough, we might take some questions now. So if you wanna raise your hand if you've got a question.
Is the hyperspace in Star Wars anything like the hyperdrive, matter, antimatter in Star Trek?
Ah, that's a good question. So the question is the hyperspace in Star Wars anything like matter, antimatter, warp drive in Star Trek? And it's not exactly. Star Trek's trying to be more scientific, but they're taking matter, combining it with antimatter as the energy source, and then they're just warping space. They're folding, like, space that is in our universe. Hyperspace is like going out of the space in our universe and coming back into it from another place. I don't know. What do you have?
Well, the important thing is that with warp drive, you're still within the rules of general relativity, so you're just warping space-time without having, like, a different dimension. You don't need any new dimensions for warp drive.
Other questions? Lightsabers. Let's let up. Do we have the other talks on here? Other slides. Can you find it? All right. Any other questions? I got a random question about lightsabers, but while we look that up, is there any other questions? Right here, right down here. Are there 8 or 9 rays in the Death Star? Well, there's 8 if you don't count the one in the middle. If you count the one in the middle, then there's 9. So I think that's the answer. That's a good question, though. Anybody else? Other questions? Right here.
I I could have heard it wrong, but is a parsec a measure of distance or time?
Fucking distance. It's having a parallactic angle of one arc second. So it's all about angles and stuff.
Yeah, that was like, we started off this talk with that whole parsec thing, but then it made us too mad.
Okay, except for the fact that in general relativity, you often, since time is like equivalent to spatial dimensions, like presumably if you're doing hyperspace and stuff, you're in a universe where like general relativity is just the way that you go. So I feel like even now we should refer to time in spatial dimensions by multiplying CT, right? So, I mean, I don't know. That's not how they've ever explained it, though. They've just been like, oh, we were talking about something else. Yeah. Yeah, we want the lightsaber slide.
What?
Okay, any other questions? We're getting to lightsabers in 1 second here. Here we go. All right. I knew somebody was going to ask about lightsabers. We had an argument about, I thought there should be lightsabers in the talk. All right. All right. Here's the deal. Could you get a lightsaber? Okay. Two things. One, if it's just light, it would just go off to infinity, so you can't have that. It could be plasma, so you could contain it in a magnetic field. That's just ionized gas. Okay. But you can calculate how much energy would you need in a lightsaber, because they stick the lightsaber in a door and then it just melts the door, right? And so you can actually calculate from physics how much energy is involved in that, okay, which I did for an article I wrote. And then what it comes out to be is a lot, about as much energy as an average home uses in a day, okay? So a lot of energy is in that little handle, so your lightsaber handle would get really hot, but also it requires about, if you think of like cell phone batteries as like our best batteries, it's like basically, I don't know if I have it written down here, but like 100 times the energy density of your cell phone. So you could, in the Star Wars universe, if you had a cell phone, you could use it for 100 days because they have lightsabers.
Okay, let's thank Andy and Chelsea one more time. Okay, before the costume contest, we want to tell you about a few more events happening this month. Okay. So next Tuesday, you can bike the solar system, okay, right here in Goleta and Santa Barbara. We're starting the solar cycle, so you can bike through this path, all the scale. So this is organized by Austin, one of our software engineers at LCOGT, and I'll let him tell you a little bit about it.
We have any cyclists in the club? Yeah. All right, you're going to want to check this out. So next week, starting Tuesday, the solar system's going to appear on the Auburn Trail. All right, the sun's going to be at MODOK. Neptune is going to be at LCOGT in the form of chalk planets. So come check it out. It's going to be cool. If you do it on Wednesday, you can finish at the open house at LCOGT. It's going to be a good time.
Thanks, Austin. So, yeah, Wednesday, we have an open house over at our observatory headquarters in Goleta. Feel free to come. You can see what a telescope factory looks like. We have a telescope, fully operating telescope out back. You can talk to the scientists, talk to the engineers, talk to the people who make this happen, and we'll be happy to answer your questions and show you around what we do there. Finally, the Wednesday after that, May 18th, we have a very special visitor coming to Santa Barbara, the director of the SETI Institute. SETI stands for the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. So more on searching for life on other planets. He'll be giving a talk at the Center Stage Theater, and you need to get tickets for that if you want to come. It's free, but you need to get tickets. So all the information is on our website and on the pamphlets that are around here. In other places. Okay, so if you have a costume, we have prizes for you. We have beer glasses with astronomy on tap on them. We have, Andy, do you want to... Andy's oven mitt here, which he mentioned earlier. And... what is this? Star Wars chopsticks?
Yeah, it's lightsaber chopsticks.
Oh, lightsaber chopsticks. Okay.
And our puppet, I am not a cave. All right.
Okay.
So, all right. So anybody that's in a costume that wants to be judged in the costume competition, come on up to the stage. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Woo! Yes. All right, come on up.
Look at this.
She's in. Right, put this over here. All right, any other costumes? All right. Let's go in order. If anybody else wants to come as a latecomer, come on up. But all right. Oh, yeah. Here we go. All right. So I'm going to have each person tell me who you're dressed as. Because I probably know, I know most of them, but not everybody. So you can tell us who you are, too.
I am the princess called Leia.
Wampa.
Rey.
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope. Bloop, bloop, bloop.
I'm Derek. I'm just an average stormtrooper. Close the blast doors.
And since the science is screwed up, I'm a physicist, works with the Rebel Alliance to get things straightened out.
All right, now I'm going to hold my hand over each person. We'll have applause for each person, and we'll narrow it down to like three, and then we'll go from there. Okay, or four, right? We're going to narrow it down to four.
What? Two at the end.
Two at the end. All right. So let's hear it for Leia. For the Wampa. All right, for Rey. All right, for another Leia. For R2-D2. All right, for Lando. All right, for Stormtrooper. And Rebel Physicist.
It's hard.
I know, it's tough. So, I know Lando made it, and I know Rey made it, and I think Wampa was also in there, and then, man, it's tough. What's... Two, three, four, Leia. Wait, hold on. Other Leia, or R2. All right, out of that, I'm going to say R2. Sorry. All right, out of those four, okay. Thanks, everybody, for participating in the costume contest. All right, now, we're going to re-vote for the top. We're going to go down the order for the top four, okay. So, Wampa. Rey. R2 and Lando. Damn. All right. We're going to go. Lando has first pick. All right. I think Lando's got first pick at the prizes here.
Okay. So. First of all, the Astronomy on Tap famous beer glass. And then, pick of. Where's
the chopsticks? Oh, they're right up on stage there.
Oh. Yeah, lightsaber
chopsticks.
All right,
either lightsaber chopsticks or space slug. Hey, it's in Empire Strikes Back. It's a good choice. Yeah. All right, second, I think, was Rey.
Woo!
All right, Ray, I think you also get lightsaber chopsticks as well. Yeah. And then...
Okay.
And then, is that, okay. Is that it?
That's. Let's thank all our costume contestants.
Woo!
So we will now raffle two more beer glasses, even if you don't have a costume. If you do have a raffle ticket, listen up for your number. Okay. First raffle ticket prize, number 280. Is 280 in the room? 280. 280, are you here? 280. Yeah, congratulations. Okay. One more. 239. Is 239 in here? 239. Yeah, 239. Congratulations. Okay. So, let's see here. Okay, so we want to thank everyone for coming. We want to thank the people behind the scenes who make this happen and you don't see them, which are Dustin here on the sound, Brian on all the technical things, and Lorna way in the back, without which none of this would happen. And let's thank Andy and Chelsea again, and Charlotte. Have a good time.
Anya.